Welcome back all to 8-Bit Benny versus the Ferret Business. We've had a bit of an issue with recording this week. I have already gone and recorded this episode, only to go to edit it and realize, for some reason, Bandicam lost all my settings. I'm going to blame Windows. And, of course, I had no audio because it was not recording my microphone and it was set to record the audio from the computer, not the headset that I'm using. So, it was pretty and all, but there was no narrative and no game sounds. So let's re-record this episode and I'll take you a walk through what I did as opposed to constructing it with you. But you know what? In the end, that might be better because it's going to make this episode a bit shorter. So without further ado, let's get to opening our Alphenheim portal so that I can show you how I finished constructing our mana tree farm. All right, let's just spin around here. Nice tower. Alright, so what we have here is we have our gate with our Elven Gateway core. We have some mana in our mana pool with our Natura Pylon on top. And again, if you open up your normal Lexica Botanica, click on Alphenheim Portal, you can page through to a page that says Visualization. If you close the book, you can now place this portal somewhere on the ground and the book will show you where to place everything. Obviously I don't want to do that because I already have one. So I told them I already got one. All right, so what are we going to do to activate this portal? Well, I'm going to right click on here, this Elven Gateway core with my Wand of the Forest. Boom. And ta-da, it's going to spark up. We're going to see a cool little particle effect around our Natura Pylons. And we're going to see it's pulling mana out, but it's not horrific. So, how does this gateway work? Well, we're going to toss stuff through it. So, if we look at our portal book right now, our Alphenheim book, let's go to the Portal to Alphenheim. So, probably saying that wrong. Alphenheim? Anyway. So, once we can see that entry, it's pretty bare. Let's toss that in there. Haha, of course, I already had a one that I've done, because I did in the previous episode. So, if we open it up, Elvengard. So, it's going to give us a narrative. They're going to say, greetings, we noticed that our portal was opened via a link from another world. So, there's a whole message from the elves on the other side of the portal. Obviously, we can't jump through because it will kill us. But we're going to see on an Alphamancy page that we now have a message, resources, apiary, I believe. Yeah, so it's to do with the bees. Elven lore, Ritual of Gaia. That's going to be a tough one. Fighting the Gaia Spirit is not very fun. I have not yet fought the Gaia Spirit 2 because it's a tougher version of that one, and I have troubles with that one. And relics. So if we look at the resources, which is really what we're after, it's going to show us that if we throw living wood in, we're going to get dream wood, which we can use to construct dream wood twigs and a better mana spreader. If we throw in mana steel, we're going to get elementium, which is going to be handy. The big one we want is mana pearls into pixie dust. The pixie dust is what we need to add to a mana lens to create our warp lens. So, and so on and so forth. Of course, I haven't been mining in a while, so I'm a little short on some of the resources. So, let's do this. Let's throw this in. And we're going to see, woohoo, we get four back. If we throw in two mana steel ingots, we're going to get one elementium back. And if we throw in, oh, does the nether quartz work? Let's find out. Yep, there we go. I don't think mana quartz does. Let's see what happens. What happened to the mana quartz? It went goodbye. So, because this does not transform mana quartz into anything, basically it ate it. So, I just lost that mana quartz. But that's okay. I can make more. So, now that I'm done with the gate, I'm going to axe out our Elven Gateway core. Plant it back there, and the gate is turned off. That means all the mana that is left in these pools will be saved. So, let's head on over and we're going to go check out the tree farm, which is now fully functional. So let's dump some stuff in here. For anyone who didn't know, to make the warp lens, if you have a mana lens, you put it next to pixie dust and you get a warp lens. It's a pretty easy recipe. By using a warp lens and a a bore lens and a warp lens, and you connect them using next to each other in a crafting grid, and you put a slime ball next to them. It joins them together into a combined lens. So we're gonna see our mana farm here. It's working pretty well. Got trees that have been stripped down. We're sending mana. Mana goes over there, really good. But what about these trees? Well, let's go take a look down below. And we're gonna check our ender pearls. Nope, none of them are ready to harvest yet. So I think we just missed it. So, interesting thing I had issues with was that when I originally set this up, I had used mana spreaders, not pulse mana spreaders. One of the keys, of course, is to have the hovering hourglass do the timing of when these mana spreaders fire. At the moment, I have set these to 2 minutes. So you can see that these pulse mana spreaders shoot, they're trying to aim for these mana pools. They enter the force relay, which I have linked by right-clicking with my wand of the forest to a piece of dirt above, sorry, a piece of podzol, which is above those ones, which then sends the blast all the way up the stair, all the way up top, and it breaks the trees. Once those spots are empty, the Runing Carpus here will plant a sapling in its place. Luckily, those blasts, even when they go off, if there's no tree here, if it's just a sapling, they do not destroy the sapling, which is great because that means I don't have to toy with the exact timing of the hourglass. So you can see there's two soul sand in there right now. The interesting thing I found is that because we have the warp bore lens, when the mana goes up and destroys the wood, well, it doesn't destroy the wood, it harvests it, it knocks it out, which means the blocks can be collected. All the wood blocks pop out down here. When I originally built this in Cloud 9, I had all of this upstairs with the trees, so it wasn't an issue, and I didn't realize it was warping them to somewhere else. In this case, it was a bit of an issue because we had stuff gathering down here. And of course, the Hopper Hawk couldn't gather the wood to make the charcoal to fuel our mana generation down here. So, what is this whole setup? Well, obviously, once the wood's down here, we need to collect it. So, this Hopper Hawk is set up next to a hopper. The hopper has an item frame with a piece of birch wood in it so that all that can go into this hopper, the only thing that the hopper hawk will put into this hopper is the birch wood. So the birch wood then goes into this furnace, which is a vanilla furnace, because we have our exo flame here. The exo flame, which is linked to the same mana pool as our Runing Carpus up top, it powers this furnace. So you can see there's no fuel down here. It's burning because the exo flame is using mana to generate heat, which then burns a piece of birch wood, turns it into charcoal, which is great. The reason this hopper is not pulling everything out is that we have a redstone torch here. So the redstone torch, when it is on, stops the hopper from spitting anything out of it. Right now, the hopper has a decent amount of charcoal in it. And what happens is it feeds into this open crate. I used an open crate on this side instead of a dropper because I wanted to make this more complicated, I guess. If I had just used a dropper here, I could have used a dropper and then just the hourglass and saved all my headaches there. But I want to do it this way because I want to do an experiment. So this is also the way Riskable did it in his build, which I will link to in the show notes below. But the open crate is great because it drops things directly straight down. The dropper itself has a bit of variance to it, so the open crate will drop straight below it, which is nice because you get a bit of accuracy. So how does the redstone torch work? Well, we have this mana hovering hourglass, which triggers once the time runs out, 30 seconds, with 30 pieces of sand in there. It flips over, causing a redstone signal to go through our repeater, which is set to 4 ticks. So it turns off this, so it The redstone signal goes into this block, the cobblestone, which then turns off our redstone torch, which allows the hopper to spit some charcoal into the open crate. So, which is great because the open crate then drops it here where the endoflames, sorry, will grab it and turn it into mana. Now, we have the endoflames. We have, sorry, is it three of them? No. So these two endoflames are linked to this mana spreader. You do need to bind these endoflames to a mana spreader so that as they generate mana, they will send it to a spreader. This spreader is set to push the mana up and refill that pool, which is good because we have the Exoflame and the Ruinen Carapace pulling off that pool. So we need to make sure it has mana. The other two endoflames are feeding this mana pool in here. If you can see, there's a mana pool in the center. The mana pool in the center is what all of the pulse mana spreaders are feeding from. So they get their mana from this pulse, from these pulse mana spreaders, all four of them, get their mana from the mana pool in the center. So these two endoflames are sending mana to that one to keep it full. So when they shoot mana out, they have mana to shoot. If this pool is empty, these would stop shooting mana, which means the bear trees up top would not get automatically knocked down. Now, because I was worried that with the Hopper Hawk over here might not reach anything that spills out over here, and or if ever this system got full of birch wood and could not continue to pick stuff up, I have put this Hopper Hawk in as a supply, as a, an emergency backup. So if there's anything left over, I do have it on a piece of mycelium so that it will act last. And if anything's left over, it'll put it into this chest. So as we can see right now, we actually have quite a bit of stuff in this chest because I believe what's happening is this timer for 30 seconds is probably a bit long for what these endoflames are doing. I did take some of the charcoal because I had a bunch of it and turned it into charcoal blocks. I have a feeling because the charcoal blocks burn longer than a piece of charcoal, they were dumping down the endoflames were still burning and they weren't picking it up before our Hopper Hawk did. You will notice the endoflames are planted on Podzol so that the Hopper Hawk here has a chance to pick up any loose wood around here before these grab it and burn it. So just trying to make sure that the wood gets pulled up and turned into charcoal so that because the charcoal will give a longer burn time, so which means more mana. So let's take some of this stuff out and let's see if we can fix this a bit. Oops. So let's put that in there. Let's see if we can split that up a bit. Sure. Let's do that. Let's see if that'll help. Although it looks like we're doing pretty good for mana down here. Let's go check up top. How's our mana up here? Yeah, our mana pool is pretty full up here, so that's pretty cool. So we're not in any worries. In fact, I could actually take one of the other endoflames and link them to the mana pool in the center, which would then send all the mana up here. When the mana does emit from this podzol block, which is linked to the force relay downstairs, it goes up and it gets collected by these mana pools up here. So anything that's being generated in that center mana pool is being sent to here, which is being sent to our central mana pool, which is, of course, sending mana back to our collection area back in the tower. So that means we are not wasting any mana. At this point, I have a feeling we're going to find that the. I have a feeling this mana pool and the one below are going to fill up. And they're going to end up probably being full, and I'm okay with that. Because that means if anything happens in the system, I've got a bit of a buffer that will keep the system going while I'm not paying attention. So, because ideally, now, while I'm at base, anything I do, there will be mana being generated by this system here. So this is a set it and forget it system now. I do not have to hopefully touch the system. Maybe once I get the timing of the charcoal drops down and stuff like that. So the other way we could automate this is instead of using the hoppers downstairs, we could say incorporate a ender chest that's coded specifically, and we could have something dumping trees and stuff like that in there. One of the things I do need to do is over yonder on the other tower is a tree farm, so that I was worried. One of the issues we have is we're running out of saplings. I was worried we're going to run out of saplings. The nice thing about this system is when the trees grow, sometimes the munchdews will eat some of the leaves closer to the trunk and leaving space between that leaf and the ones on the outside, which causes those leaves that aren't attached to the trunk to despawn. Sometimes those will drop saplings, which is great because that will fill back up into our hopper over there. That being said, it doesn't happen often, so I have made a tree farm over there, which has no mana spreaders or munchdews or anything. So what I might do is I'll probably make another set of pulse mana spreaders and set up another tree destroying area over there, except that I won't have any munchdews and I'll just have it collect all of the saplings in the wood and send it back over here. So I could use an ender chest to get it from there to over here and set it up by one of the hoppers and stuff like that. So that would be a way to make this system more efficient. But at this point, I'm pretty happy with the way this is, which means we can move on to the next project next week. What are we gonna look at next week? We are gonna finally get that chunk loader up and running now that we have some mob essence from our blaze spawner tower over yonder. And we're gonna see if we can get it set up, because once we get it set up, that means we can get into power generation at the base. All right, all. That's going to be it for this week. I'm really hoping you're liking the episodes. If you are liking the episodes, feel free to thumbs up. I appreciate the thumbs up because, hey, it tells me that someone's enjoying this more than just myself. Also, if you really like the episodes, feel free to subscribe so that you will find out when new episodes arrive. I do try to release an episode every week, have been doing pretty good, except for that couple weeks I had to go to Star Wars thanks to that roguelike dungeon. And if you do like it a lot, feel free to share with your friends. All right, all. I will see you all next week for more Feed the Beast Ferret Business Fun. See yas. Bye-bye.